were reunited over here by the Crowd of Terror. The missing child has been accounted for. The ice cream is in order. Our marshal was just saying that Damien Shore has actually moved one of the concrete piles, as I said, blocks that are surrounding the track, so we'll have to take a few moments to replace that. Damien Shore following Alan Sinnott's line of shot. We've seen this many times, especially in the likes of Portishead.
He just seems to be on fire yesterday. And I mean, taking that line he did in the last run, I don't know if that's going to come against him from the judges.
Just as they're waiting, Sean, just to go through, you've got to run back to the guys who have actually qualified so far and a little bit of the story so far.
Yeah, I mean, we've got Brendan Stone beating Gavin Mulvey in the first tackle. I mean, two very good drivers. There wasn't much between them, so Brendan will be a major contender here today. We also have John Hickey. John, yesterday.
The dream continues, Sean, for John Hickey.
Yeah, I mean, it's unreal. I don't know how he's actually still here today, because the way that man was going towards walls yesterday, I don't know how he did it.
But it had a huge impact in the semi-final and semi-pro. I mean, I thought the car was done. It was rolled off. I'm sure the guys, especially all the guys with Team Manfoot, would have stuck together trying to get that car out here today. And boy, is he doing them proud by being in the top eight of a pro. This man turned up last year, at the start of last year, first year, in a standard car, and 1 year later, he's in the top eight of a pro final. So goes to show the talent of John Hickey there. I said, doesn't seem to be fading under the pressure either.
No, definitely not. I mean, as you said there, PS14 he was riding last year. He's very, very same driving style in the S14 as he does this year in the corner, so I don't think it matters what car he has. He's just a good aggressive driver.
And of course, our next one, we saw Paul McCarthy beat Mike Dean. I know when you have a few drinks on, you do get a little bit overconfident. But Paul McCarthy, even with all that overconfidence, said he was very, very wary of getting to a top 16. He said the field was too strong. Then to go ahead and beat Mike Dean, our champion from 2 years ago, saw a huge weekend for Paul McCarthy.
Yeah, it is, and as you said, I've known a lot of drivers over the last couple of years. And if you meet them all on Saturday night, they couldn't string a sentence together. But these are the guys that seem to perform the best on a Sunday.
I suppose it's just getting through without any nerves is the way to do it. But I said Paul McCarthy is a very talented driver. And I do think with Paul McCarthy, I've noticed over the years, he's very aggressive in twin battle. He doesn't seem to hold. I mean, he's probably pulled the front of that BMW at least 5 times at this stage. Remember last year, Punch said he hit the wall very, actually hit the back of Brian Connor, as far as I remember, very, very hard. And the guys tied the front end to a van, pulled it straight, and he went out to finish second in that round. The car almost rolled off. So it's just a never say die attitude with the McCarthy. Seems to be shining today.
Yeah, I mean, the captains, it's all being done with the captains. They know I'm inside out. So I suppose maybe Paul isn't that worried about reshelling on at some stage.
Of course, you always have the hand-me-down factor. That used to be John Paul McCarthy's car. So I suppose the normal families would be handed down a jacket or a hoodie. He handed them down a 3-punch of Ray Horsman around 3. So, as I said, looking very competitive. And I'm sure John Paul will be looking on. I'm feeling a little bit nervous now that the younger brother has gone through to the top 8. Puts a bit of nerves on, I suppose, the favourite almost in John Paul.
Yeah, I suppose it will. It's like anything. You're always going to look up to your older brother, but when your younger brother is beating on a Sunday into the top 16,
it puts the pressure on around the dinner table on a Monday evening. Now, if John Paul McCarthy, I'm sure John Paul McCarthy, as we know, the two of them are like thick as thieves, and he will be delighted that Paul is having a great weekend. I suppose it's a bonus that he's getting as far as he is too. So we have a couple more battles to go, because the guys and the marshals just straighten up those walls as they're moved quite heavily by Damien Shore. I'm just waiting for our marshals to report whether Damien Shore's car is badly damaged. I said it just seems to go from bad to worse. I said the bodywork specialist around Damien Shore must have his hands full.
Yeah, I mean, I will tell you a lot about him. I mean, he actually shelled his car last season. I'll just show you, he's not afraid. He's an aggressive driver.
And I said, we mentioned earlier was the fact that in practice in Formoli 2 years ago, he actually rode off a car almost. Then the car was destroyed here last year in practice again. He wasn't even making it to qualify. I mean, when you think about it, you're leaving your house, you're spending months building a car, you're leaving your house with a transport and a trailer, traveling all the way here, and then you get to the event, and before you even get into the qualifying, the car is destroyed. It is disheartening, man. It goes to show the character of Damien to come back and not only get through the whole of amateur and semi-finals are qualifying, to get through until the Sunday and into the top 16 where seven big drivers were eliminated.
Yeah, I mean, like, these guys, they eat, sleep, and drink pro drift. They love drifting. It's all they ever think about.
We're just waiting on the crane just to straighten up those concrete blocks. As I said, they look immovable, but when you hit it at the force, and it just goes to show, Sean, the force that Damien Short did hit that wall.
Yeah, I mean, like, these guys try and lighten their cars as much as they can. All they can do is put a roll cage around them, and they're still not afraid to put it all out there.
And of course, that goes to show that the stringent scrutiny and safety regulations you go through here in Progress, as I said, every car has to meet sometimes over FIA standards, so just to make them safe, because things like, you know, we saw Dwayne Keever hit the wall very hard earlier in the Super Lap, and he walked out of the car. I said, if the safety regulations weren't as strict as they are, he may not have done so, but unfortunately for Dwayne, as he saw the car limp off the track, a bad weekend for some drivers, and I suppose that's the harsh reality of Progress. And of course, you guys watching, it's very important to note that it is a split-second decision that means you go home a winner, or you go home with a car destroyed, and I mean, that's what makes it such a unique sport, John.
Yeah, it does, like, and you know, as you were saying there about the cars, even just take, for instance, the two MG Crash Repairers 15s, I was looking at the inside of Danny Monday's car there last week, and it would be fairly close to a WRC spec. I mean, the cages and the work that goes, the fabrication work that goes into these cars, it's unbelievable.
I suppose the story of Progress since it started to me really was, you know, we had a lot of good drivers in the same kind of machinery, and after a while the drivers got to a point where they just got more and more competitive, the cars get more and more competitive, so every year we have people, I mean, we have the likes of Mark Sinnott, and you know, in a semi-pro car, 500 brake horsepower in a semi-professional car, I mean, it's incredible to think. I said, and you also go down to the 140 brake horsepower Stephen Hart Hero ship that we saw yesterday, so such a mix of car and styles makes it so interesting here in Ireland. So Formula D and East, it's all big power, big V8s here. You've got the little guy in the Corolla taking on 400 brake. You just don't know which way to go. It just goes to show the talent and how these guys adapt to different cars.
Yeah, I remember being in World 3 there a couple of years ago, and even like James Dean driving 1.6 Sierras.
It's come a long way since then. I said, of course, it's come a long way due to the fact that, of course, a lot of our drivers, Dean Carney, Darren McNamara, Eric O'Sullivan, of course, James Dean, these guys have gone over to Formula D, done very well, got big sponsorship, and are representing our country all over the world. I mean, as I said, for such a small country to produce so many good drivers, we should be really proud of that. So, would you believe Damien Short's car is able to compete for the second half of this battle against, the second half of the war, time rather, against Alan Sinnott? Incredibly, Damien Short. It's good to glory at this stage for Damien Short. And there we go, Damien Short leads the line, Alan Sinnott.
Oh.
There's absolutely nothing left there for Alan Sinnott. Gets out of Alan Sinnott's way. Alan Sinnott will take the shot to a little more practice. He's all through there. We're asking for Damien Short. An incredible effort. He left the line there.